Well, hello, NewStory Online. Welcome to At the Movies. We are so glad that you're here, that you are joining us. Let us know in the chat, wherever you're watching from. We just want to see your typing, your emojis, your name. How are you feeling? My name is Nathan, and I'm going to be your online host for today. Now, if you're wondering what's going on here, we are at the movies. We're here at the red carpet, obviously, but people are already walking in. Some are already in the theater, and some are still on their way. So for those of you that are watching at home, welcome. And, you know, it's the last week that we have in this movie series. I hope that it's been a fun series for you so far. If it has, let us know what has been some of your favorite movies. Did you enjoy Free Solo? Did you enjoy Toy Story? Let us know in the chat. What about Hamilton last week? Well, today, of course, if you haven't noticed already, today is Top Gun. How many of you remember the original Top Gun? Yes, let us know. This is actually my father's jacket right here. My pops, he was in the Navy. Give a shout out to Rick in the chat. If you are in the chat, say hello to Rick. He's amazing. If you've watched Top Gun, that's basically him, just flying planes off an aircraft carrier. Are you kidding me? It looks super scary, but he's amazing. Say hello to him in the chat. All right, so if you've watched the original, give us a wave in the chat with a waving hand emoji, let us know. And if you're a little younger than, what was it, 1986-ish, something like that, 1986, if you're younger than that, hopefully you're out watching this new one and enjoying it. So Tom is gonna wrap up the series today, and you know, it's been a good one. So we hope that if you haven't caught it and you're just tuning in right now, wherever you're watching from, just take a moment, share this video with your friends, with your family, and whoever else that you feel might need to watch this series. It's been so encouraging just to hear how Tom's just taken these blockbuster movies, these movies that are just so fun for us to watch and entertaining, but then just bringing it all together with scripture, and it's just so encouraging. So feel free to share that. If you are new, if it's your very first time, take a moment, pull out your phone, and just go ahead and scan that QR code that's at the bottom left of your screen right now. You can just do that. Fill out a connection card. We want to get to know you a little bit better. We want to journey with you and see how we can better serve you. And speaking of journeying with you, some of you that have been watching or even have been coming in person, you have made a declaration of faith and said, taking that next step, I want to get baptized. And next Sunday, do not come here. We're still going to have a live stream, so you're going to be able to watch. For those of you that are watching that don't come in person anyways, we're going to be on the beach at Will Rogers State Beach, and we're going to have baptisms. And it's going to be so great because you're going to be encouraged by the testimonies of people that just want to confess that Jesus is Lord in their life, and they want to just make a public declaration of that by getting baptized and taking that next step. And so we're going to have a great service. It's actually at 10 a.m., so a little bit different time. There's only one service. So 10 a.m., don't miss that next week. And now we are going to get ready for this last message. Good to see this gentleman right here. He's getting prepped. He's getting ready for the keys. And just prepare your hearts wherever you're watching from, whenever you're watching this. We hope that you're encouraged, that you would engage in worship right now. And David's going to come up. He's going to give us a couple more announcements and just get us ready for what's ahead at NewStory. If you haven't already seen the new Maverick, Top Gun Maverick, if you take a moment and either in the chat or email me, Nathan@NewStoryChurch.com, that's Nathan@NewStoryChurch.com, say, hey, Nathan, I haven't seen it yet, I'm going to send you movie tickets. So I'm going to send you those tickets. Go ahead and email me or put it in the chat. But we're going to just enjoy this service right now. Thank you so much for being here. We love you. Have a great rest of your service. We'll see you soon.
Now, let's take a look at what's coming soon to a new story theater near you.
What is going on, church? It is so good to be here with all of you. Today we are wrapping up our Summer at the Movie series, and we're going to be diving into Top Gun Maverick. If you have not seen the movie Top Gun, you need to do yourself a favor and go watch it, okay? Because it's pretty awesome. Well, my name is David. I'm one of the pastors here at NewStory, and I just wanted to welcome all of you here in person and everyone tuning in online. So glad that you could join us today. Well, we have a couple of free gifts for you if you are first-time guests. If you are new here, I want to encourage you to stop by the welcome table after the service, because continuing on the theme of At the Movies, we have a free movie ticket for you and a free t-shirt. So make sure you stop by, because we'd love to connect with you afterwards. Well, speaking of newcomers, on Sunday, August 14th, we have our Welcome to NewStory gathering. If you've been attending NewStory for the past couple of months or so, and if you're new here, we want you to come out. We want to invite you to this Welcome to NewStory gathering. This is a great opportunity for you to meet some of our leaders and pastors of the church. It'll be an opportunity for you to get to know our church a little better and also meet other newcomers. And so I want you to save the date, Sunday, August 14th, 12:30 p.m. right here at NewStory. We hope to see you then. And then last but not least, next week we have our beach baptisms, okay? It's gonna be an amazing, amazing time. I don't know if you guys remember last year's beach baptism, but here's a highlight video just to kind of refresh your memories. Check this out.
Trust God, I can be vulnerable and pour out my weaknesses in prayer.
I'm very happy to declare that Jesus loves me.
I can say with a lot of confidence that the Lord has always been there for me, and He never failed me once.
So good. Next week, beach baptisms at Royal Rogers State Beach Lifeguard Tower 5 at 10 o'clock a.m. We have one service. Again, a reminder, we will not be meeting here in person. We're all going to be at the beach next week. You can point your cameras to the QR code, and it'll take you directly to the site where it has all the information that you need in terms of location, in terms of the time, in terms of all the festivities that's going to be going on. We have free lunch for you, dessert. We're going to have some ice cream. It's going to be an amazing time hearing great testimonies, witnessing the baptisms, so you do not want to miss out. Again, next Sunday, 10 o'clock a.m. at Will Rogers State Beach, we're going to celebrate together. Amen? Well, with that said, let me pray for us, and let's get our hearts ready as we get into worship. Bow with me. Heavenly Father, we come before you on another Sunday. Just so, so thankful, God, that we get to worship you. And I know everybody's coming from different places and different walks. I don't know if people had a good day coming in or a bad day. I don't know what's on people's minds. The worries, the distractions, the obstacles. But I do pray, God, that your Spirit remove those very things, so that at this moment, we're able to fix our eyes on you. That we're able to worship in spirit and in truth. So, Heavenly Father, as we come before you, would you prepare our hearts and our minds for what's to come? That as we sing the songs of praise, as we hear your word, that you would use it to do something good in our hearts, so that we might see you, we might know you, we might experience you. So God, we entrust this time to you, knowing that you're going to do a good work. So we thank you for the good God that you are. We love you, and we just want to praise you right now. We pray that in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Why don't we all rise to our feet? And just as we prepare our hearts and sing these words, let's really just give our hearts to the Lord as we just enter this time of worship together.
Kingdoms will bow down. Thank you. We adore you, Lord. You are the one true God, and you created the world and everything in it. You give us breath to our lungs, and we want to worship you and praise you with our voice, Lord. We want to declare that you are worthy, Lord. Let everything that has breath praise you, Lord. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. And you have dominion over all of the heavens and all of the earth. Yet you still care, Lord, even for the smallest details of our life, Lord. You love us so deeply. You love us so well, Lord. And sometimes, Lord, your love hurts, Lord. But we trust in you, Father. Lord, we want to just declare, Lord, that you are worthy, Lord, no matter what the circumstance, no matter what the season. And we want to thank you, Lord, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who shed his blood for us, Lord, so that we can live a free life, Lord. We can live, Lord, with purpose and meaning. And we can have a personal relationship with you, Lord, that is deep and rich, Lord. So we trust you with our lives, and we give this worship service to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Nothing like following spiritual worship with the Danger Zone. Who's glad to be here in church today? Welcome to the Danger Zone. My goodness. Who remembers that original soundtrack from the original Top Gun? Quite a few. You old. Well, whether you're young, old, or somewhere in between, welcome to New Story Church, in case we haven't met, especially for those of you tuning in online. My name is Tom. I'm one of the pastors. And today is the final installment of this summer series, At the Movies. This is a series where we've been taking a look at some of the larger God-sized themes in some of Hollywood's blockbusters. And this summer, none have been bigger in terms of blockbusters than Top Gun Maverick, which of course is the sequel to the original Top Gun, also starring Tom Cruise. This guy doesn't age. I don't know what the deal is. Which actually, this is kind of depressing. The original Top Gun came out in 1986. Okay, yeah, we got a woohoo. Okay, all right, you old. over 36 years ago, some of you weren't even, raise your hand if you weren't even born. I'm old. Okay, who actually saw the original Top Gun? Let's see some hands if you saw the original. Okay, all right, more than half of us here. Who has seen the most recent Top Gun Maverick? Okay, all right, just about to say, give me a hoop and holler if you've seen both. Let me hear you. Okay, all right, the few, the proud, the entertained. But you know what? We're not alone. Because the original Top Gun, as many of us know, was a cultural icon. As a matter of fact, did you know that when it was first released in the 80s, naval aviation applications actually increased by over 500%. Can you believe that? True story, the U.S. Navy actually set up recruitment booths outside certain strategic theaters, and young men especially would line up to sign up for the Navy. Can you just imagine that conversation at home? Like, you're a kid, you come home, Mom, yeah, I saw the movie. I also joined the Navy. Anyways, that wouldn't fly well in my house. But anyways, meanwhile, today's sequel has already become the highest grossing film, let me say this right, since the pandemic. Does that make sense, right? Like it's a post-pandemic world, and basically in the last 2+ years, it has become the highest grossing film, which is absolutely amazing. It's brought in over 1.3 billion, I said million last time, $1 billion and counting since May, which is actually incredible, right? And of course, one of the secret sauces to it, of course, is, no secret, Tom Cruise. Right? He's one of Hollywood's goats, as it were. Believe it or not, he has starred in, guess how many movies? Just throw a number out there. Just throw a number. 6? 16? 50 plus! 52 movies in his 41 years of being an actor, right? We see some of the, I mean, this guy has played everything, right? He's played a samurai, right? He's a vampire, military. I mean, some of my favorite Tom Cruise movies aren't even there, like Minority Report. You guys remember The Firm? Did anyone see The Firm? I read The Firm, like, in high school. I loved it. I wanted to, like, that's what I wanted in my life. And then Tom Cruise came out, and it was a horrible movie. Anyways, can you guess, though, of all his 50 plus, you could watch a Tom Cruise movie one a week for the rest of the year, and you still, I mean, this is crazy. Can you guess which is his highest grossing film? Where did he make the most money? Can you guess which one? Top Gun, absolutely. It's the latest one, Top Gun Maverick. Cruise has reportedly made over $100 million for playing this role, and that also is, it's counting, right? Making it one of the largest paydays ever for an actor. And to think, back in 1976, he was just a 14-year-old Franciscan seminary student who aspired to join the priesthood. Can you imagine two Pastor Toms, right? Just speaking about seminary students, though, true story, a good friend of mine, Lieutenant Commander Scott Walters, actually spent, we graduated seminary together, and then he has spent the last 20-plus years actually in the Navy. He is actually a Top Gun graduate, so you can imagine who I was on the phone with a lot this month, just kind of going over different ideas and some research, and thanks so much, Scott. I know you're watching online. But turns out that several in his crew were actually hired by the producers of the movie to actually fly the real-life F-18 Super Hornet fighter jets, right? As well as serve as technical directors throughout the project to ensure that the movie was actually as realistic as possible. And if you saw the movie, you know, it's like very realistic. In fact, there are naval officers who have said that they felt like this movie was a love letter written to the U.S. Navy. Having said that, as Scotty and I were talking, we both agreed that what makes this movie truly relatable to everyone is the fact that it shows the struggle of people dealing with their past. That's actually what makes this movie relatable, right? That's what this whole movie is about people relating with their past. It's not just about high-flying machines, but more so, it's about men and women and how they battle their past, right? See, just a quick reminder or summary, no spoiler alerts or anything, but Captain Pete Maverick Mitchell, played by Tom Cruise, is, you guys know this, he's a rebellious, unorthodox, and fiercely independent pilot, as you might have guessed from his call sign, Maverick, right? He's a Maverick. So he got this way, he has this way, right, of doing things on his own, which doesn't exactly fly in the military, right? I've never been in the military, but I do know that if you're a Maverick, that's not gonna work. You have to fall in line, right? But because of his superior aviation skills and his vast experience, he's actually called upon to train the best of the best Top Gun pilots for like this dangerous world-saving mission, right? But along the way, Maverick has to deal with his past, right? He deals with a past sort of reputation, right? Doesn't happen overnight, but you do things, you carry yourself a certain way, you build a reputation. He has to deal with that, right? He's Tom Cruise, so he deals with a past love relationship as well, right? That you see that throughout the movie. That's one of the threads, right? You see that happening. But perhaps most challenging of all, he has to deal with the past tragedy that took place when the life of his best friend and wingman, Goose, right? His life was tragically taken away. And now it turns out in the sequel that Maverick now has to train Goose's son, right? He's in the Top Gun program, right? And so you see how Maverick's past just sort of keeps on catching up with him. He's never really dealt with it properly, never really dealt with things in a healthy manner, and he's just not sure how to deal with his past. Life goes along and everything's fine, but his past keeps showing up and he doesn't know how to maneuver. He can maneuver these multi-million dollar planes, but he can't maneuver his past. So let me ask you right here, right now, what does it look like for you when your past doesn't stay in the past? Because here's what it looks like for Maverick.
Captain Pete Maverick Mitchell. Let me be perfectly blunt. You are not my first choice. You were here at the request of Admiral Kazansky, AKA Iceman. He seems to think that you have something left to offer the Navy. What that is, I can't imagine.
With all due respect, sir, I'm not a teacher. Just want to manage the expectations.
What the hell?
Good morning, aviators. This is your captain speaking.
And we're off.
Here we go. In three.
We're going into combat on a level no living pilot's ever seen.
Not even him.
You think up there you're dead? Believe me.
My dad believed in you. I'm not gonna make the same mistake.
Someone's not coming back from this.
Those are your pilots. Anything happens to them.
Smoke in the air!
You'll never forgive yourself.
No turning back now.
Come on! Jeez!
Having any fun yet?
Stay in your past. What do you do, right? Like, are there things from your past which you actually, in an unhealthy manner, carry to your present and left unchecked actually affect your future? Does that describe you in any way, shape, or form? Maybe it's a heartbreak from a certain relationship in the past. Maybe it's childhood trauma in the past. Maybe it's getting passed up again and again for another promotion at work in the past. Or, I actually think this is just as challenging, if not more, what if it's something that you did wrong rather than a wrong done to you? Right? That's a very challenging thing to deal with, right? Like, is there a mistake that you've made or a wrong you've done or a sin that you've committed, right? Maybe as a parent or a spouse, a sibling, a friend, an employee, an employer, that honestly you cannot forgive yourself of. Like, sure, you manage day to day. It doesn't come out every single moment. But in the reality is it still haunts you from your past. Some of you are kind of looking down. Is that too personal? I'm sorry, is it still too soon? Okay, how about this then? Can you name anyone in the Bible who is haunted by their past? Because here's a hint. There's actually quite a few, right? Just off the top of our heads, like Peter and Paul. Peter and Paul in the New Testament. One guy, Peter, pledges his allegiance to Jesus, and the very next second, actually in the same chapter, he denies Jesus publicly three times, to the point where a little schoolgirl, we have some schoolgirls with us right now, a little schoolgirl actually calls him out. Can you imagine how humbling, how even humiliating that would be? You know, afterwards, Peter is so dejected and bewildered, he literally just goes back to his old life of fishing. He's like, Jesus was trending. I got caught up in the whole thing. It's not really for me. I don't know what you're talking about. No, I'm just going to go back to my old way of life. You know, meanwhile, Paul, who wrote nearly half the books of the New Testament, right, 13 of them, he's the same one who admits of his past. Yeah, you know, I am the guy who persecuted the church of God violently. I actually tried to destroy it. Oh, now what do? Now I try to convert Gentiles. Do you know Jesus? See, do you think that he was affected by his past? Or his ministry was affected by his past? But you know, there's another example, this one from the Old Testament that I would love for us to spend the remaining of our time today diving deeper, because it provides some great insights on how to deal with our past, for those of you taking notes. We're gonna see some insights on how to deal with our past, and it comes to us from the life, one of my favorites, Moses. Okay, so we're gonna press pause on Maverick, and we're gonna pick up Moses. If you have your Bibles, if you have an app, go ahead and turn to Exodus chapter 2. We're going to camp out here for the rest of the day. And as you do that, let me sort of set the table here contextually, okay? Moses, we need to remember and understand, was born, similar to Jesus, centuries later. Moses was born during an extremely oppressive period when the reigning king, in this case the Egyptian king, actually put an order out that all Hebrew baby boys were to be killed. Actually, you can go ahead and throw them into the Nile. That's actually what Scripture says. And yet Moses, somehow he escaped this atrocity. As a matter of fact, not only did he escape, but because of his quick-thinking older sister Miriam, an arrangement was made. This is earlier in Exodus. We see this. An arrangement was made for Moses to grow up actually inside of the Egyptian palace while being raised by his Hebrew mother, who, by the way, got paid to raise him. How many of you parents would love to be paid to raise your kid, yeah? We got a few, couple of smiles and amens. So don't miss this, right? This is absolutely crazy, yeah? Moses not only miraculously gains his life, but he also won the lottery. That's how you have to think about it. Not only was he the only Hebrew boy of his time, but he's growing up in a palace by his mom, who's getting paid, right? Which is where our opening scene actually picks up today. I'm in Exodus chapter 2, verse 11, where it says this: one day, Moses had grown up. He went out to his people. His people were the Hebrews. He went out to his people and looked on their burdens, and he saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his people. He looked this way and that, looked here and there, and seeing no one, what did he do? He struck down the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. Friends, have you ever had good intentions but the wrong actions? Like you meant well, you really did, but somewhere along the line, things went south and you did the wrong thing and it blows up in your face. See, in Hebrew, the word there, they use the word marriage. In Greek, it's the word parenting, okay? See, seriously, though, Moses had the right intentions to liberate the people of God, the Hebrews, but he went about it in the completely wrong way. You see, killing an Egyptian and burying him in the sand wasn't exactly part of God's intention, right? It's not what God had in mind. So if you're taking notes, jot this down. Right intentions plus wrong decisions equals poor actions. You can have the right intentions, make the wrong decisions, and equal poor actions. Now, notice, I didn't say poor results. That's not always true, but it is poor actions. We're going to get into that a little bit more. This actually happens a lot, right? Whenever we take matters into our own hands, whenever I decide to do things my way rather than God's way and in His timing, I inevitably make a mess. It somehow catches up to me. Maybe soon, maybe later, but inevitably it's a mess. And so what is that for you today? Like, in what area of your life are your intentions good? Maybe even godly. Let's call them godly, right? But you're going about it your own way. Is there anything like that in your life? See, there's no question God wanted to use Moses to lead the Hebrews out of Egypt. There's no question. I mean, Moses was literally handpicked. He was hand-carved, right? He was born a Hebrew, raised by a Hebrew, yet within the Egyptian palace, under Egyptian culture and education. So yeah, God was orchestrating a one-of-a-kind leader and liberator for His people. It's just that murder and a cover-up weren't part of God's plan. Does that make sense? So what is that for you today? Where are you getting in God's way for you? God is for you, but where are you getting in His way for you? Where do you have good intentions, maybe even godly ones, but the actions and decision-making process don't actually match? They don't align. And that's an important question. See, a significant fact that we all need to understand, again, if you're taking notes, jot this down. Actions, not just intentions, have led you to where you are right now, good, bad, or indifferent. Does that make sense? Oh, his intentions were good. No. Actions, not just intentions, have led you to where you are right now. This was the case for Moses back then, and this principle is still true for us today. Actions, not just intentions, have led you to where you are this moment. We need to own that. We need to own that. And I could stop this message right here, but you know what? Thankfully, we need to see where Moses' actions actually lead him, where his actions, not just intentions, actually lead him. Watch this. If you skip down to verse 13, it says this. When he went out the next day, behold, two Hebrews. Now, these are his people, right? Two Hebrews were struggling together. And he said to the man in the wrong, the Hebrew that was in the wrong, why do you strike your companion? And that guy that was in the wrong, his fellow brother, answered, whoa, who made you a prince and judge over us? Whoa, you think because you're a Hebrew, but you grew up in that palace, you're my boss? You're not the boss of me. What do you think you are? You're not special. Do you mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian? Oh, no. He got caught. They know. I don't know. The text doesn't say if they were hiding in a bush. The text doesn't say if gossip started to linger around the village, but somehow this guy knows. He knows. You gonna do to me like you did to him yesterday? Then, watch this, the fear of God. Then Moses was what? What's the word there, church? Then Moses was afraid. Oh, dang. They caught me. They saw me. Word's out. It's going viral. It's on TikTok. It's on the gram. Somebody caught me. Surely the thing is known. Verse 15. When Pharaoh heard of it, He sought to kill Moses, but Moses fled from Pharaoh and stayed in the land of Midian. I want you to remember that. He stayed in the land of Midian. Now, friends, do you see what's happening here? Let's just pause right here for a second, right? Don't miss this. Moses' past, albeit it was only a day ago, and that's actually irrelevant. It could be a day, it could be years ago. But Moses' past has caught up to him. He didn't think it would. It wasn't even in his mind. He's like lecturing and preaching to his people. It caught up. His past actions caught up to him. And so what happens next? He panics. Whoa, and literally tries to outrun now his past. He's not going to deal with it. He's not going to do anything. He's going to try to outrun it. Only to wind up in the land of Midian. If you're taking notes, this is called the wilderness. If you talk to Bible scholars today, the interesting thing is no one can quite pinpoint exactly where the land of Midian is. But what scholars will agree is that it's this region that's surrounded by desert, wilderness, things that cannot grow, places where you don't want to live, okay? And now, mind you, he actually spends, do you know how long he stays there? The next 40 years. Guys, he did this wrong in the past. It catches up with him. He tries to outrun it. He winds up in the wilderness for the next 40 years. Turn to your friend and say 40. 40 years he winds up in the land of Midian. Now, if you don't think that can happen today, you are either not being honest or you simply have not lived long enough yet. Like you were born after the original Top Gun, okay? Because just trust me on this, it happens. It happens. See, friends, for the next 40 years of Moses' life, this privileged, full of promise and potential Moses was completely derailed and living in the wilderness in total obscurity. Think about this. Why? Well, let's be real. It was because of his own failure. It's because he failed in one given moment of time. Failure brought Moses to the wilderness. Facts. But do you know what kept him there? Fear. Fear kept him there. Failure brought him there, but fear kept him there. Fear of Pharaoh. Fear of consequences. The fear of what his fellow Hebrews would say. The fear that maybe, I think this is just as real, the fear that, you know, maybe I'm not really who I thought I was. Maybe my life isn't supposed to go the way that it was. I would call this a sort of beta version of the imposter syndrome. If you're taking notes, you need to understand, failure brought Moses to the wilderness. Fear kept him there for the next 40 years. Now, how does this apply to your life today? Do you get hung up on mistakes that you've made a while ago? Still feel like God's punishing you? Trying to teach you a lesson? Maybe cursed you even? Or maybe this, like, have you ever been in a situation where everyone's forgiven you for a wrong that you've done or a mishap? They've forgiven you. They've forgotten about a long time ago, but you, like, still carry that. You can't forgive yourself. Have you ever noticed that sometimes the hardest person to forgive is yourself? Have you ever noticed that? Yeah? Maybe today you live in guilt and shame, even to this moment. Do you know, I was sharing this with the service before. I know people, no one in this church, I know people that are in their 60s and 70s who are still living and striving for the approval of their parents who've passed many, many years before. How is your past a part of you today? Past failures and current fears, you have to, these are like the two, like, heaviest pieces of baggage you can carry. I can't think of anything heavier than past failures and current fears. It keeps you stuck. It's too heavy. And so here's where I want to pause and ask you a super practical question. Can I do that? I want to ask you this practical question. Friends, do you have a safe environment to unpack your baggage? Your past fears or your past failures and your current fears. Do you have a place to unpack your baggage with like the right people? Hopefully it's your small group, right? Or some trusted friends and family, maybe a pastor or a counselor for a season. Can I just be totally candid with you? Over the last 2+ years, like during this pandemic, one of the best things I did for myself, right? Self-care, I know that's like a really popular thing now. One of the best things I did for myself over the last 2+ years was actually to join a Celebrate Recovery group specifically for pastors. So I think I've shared this before, but you need to know your pastor has hurts, habits, and hang-ups. And I can't deal with them on my own, right? And so for the last 2 years, I've been in this Celebrate Recovery group. We've been going over it weekly. It's amazing. Right, we actually have a Celebrate Recovery group here at church, at New Story Church. There's some of our leaders. Every Monday they meet. They've been meeting throughout the pandemic. We started it right before, thank God. They've been meeting throughout. They meet every Monday. Right, you can go online or go to our website. You can find out more information. You feel uncomfortable coming in person? Well, no one here does, but if you're online and you feel uncomfortable, you can meet online as well. Tremendous ministry, tremendous ministry. I honestly don't think that there's anyone, let me just state it positively, everyone I know could benefit from Celebrate Recovery. There's not a man, woman, or child I know that wouldn't benefit deeply. I'll just, even more, like even before the last 2 years, so for the 3 years previous, your pastor was in weekly counseling. For 3 years, every Thursday morning. That was an amazing environment to unpack some of my baggage, right? And to be quite honest, if you've known me for a while, you already know this. You ask my wife. All throughout this time, since seminary, actually, thinking about Scotty right now, since seminary, since the day that we, like, even like right before we got married, we Eric and I have been married in August. It'll be 22 years. So I remember even the years before, a couple of years before that, I don't know how it started. Or it's been the most tremendous, probably one of the most influential things in my life is I've always been surrounded by 3 to 4 guys, 3 to 5 men, actually, who I regularly go deep with intentionally. Like every week I'm in contact. And sometimes different seasons of life, it changes. But 3 to 5 guys who, here's the key, you have to find people who are not impressed with you. You have to intentionally find people. They can call your bluff. These are not the people you want to play poker with and call you out. They know. They can sniff it. They're not impressed with you. You can't pull the wool over their eyes. And for the last 20 plus years, I've had the privilege of being able to walk with guys like this. These men, here's what it is. They're not impressed with me at all or the things I do or what I say, but they do love me. And they love Jesus. And we have been intentional about keeping that kind of environment, that kind of bond. Some of you guys, you need to have that. Nothing is off limits. You have to intentionally seek that. So let me ask you, what is your system? Like, what is your plan? What is your plan for unpacking the baggage of your own failures and fears? Or like, are you like just leaving it up to chance? Or even worse yet, do you actually think you don't have any? Because that would not only be hubris, that's just like, it's like a rookie move. See, the reality is, here's the stone cold truth, all right? And I want to change my tone here because I want you to know it comes from a place of love. But the reality is, some of you right now are living in the land of Midian. And you have been for years. But you don't even realize it. Because it's like wallpaper now. It's like carpet. You don't even notice like the color and the patterns anymore. It's not novel anymore. It's not new. It just kind of blends into the background, blends into the landscape. And so year after year after years go by, and you don't even realize you're living in the wilderness. Because, by the way, you still have your job. You're still paying the bills. Life keeps going on. But you're not actually living. Some of you are living way too small. Got really quiet in here. Some of you are like, dang, bro, I just came for the popcorn. But seriously, here's the thing. God has so much more for you. He just does. He has so much more for you. God doesn't want you to stay in the land of Midian. You weren't created to wither in the wilderness. This is not how your story ends. Nor is it how it should continue. Which is why I'm so thankful that Moses' story continues in chapter 3 where we pick it up. It says this. Now, Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of, guess where? The wilderness. By the way, notice, Moses has gone from the palace to the pit, okay? He's gone from living in a palace like a prince to now the most deplorable job you could have at the time. You don't want to put that on your resume. You're a sanitational engineer. You're dealing with wild stock, animals, the flock. You're nothing. You're nobody. Moses was keeping the flock of his father in the wilderness, Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness. So like that's like the wilderness of the wilderness. So he's got this dirty job. He's in the wilderness, and he goes to the wilderness of the wilderness and came upon to Horeb, the mountain of God, and the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. This is weird. Is this a mirage? Am I seeing this right? And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. I don't know if that's like, I guess Moses and I are different. I just wouldn't react. I will turn aside to see this great sight. Why the bush is not? I'd be like, yo, do you see that, bro? Oh my God, let's check this out, right? Nevertheless, verse 4. When the Lord saw that Moses had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And God said, do not come near. You come any closer, bro, you're gonna like spontaneously combust. You can't handle my holiness. You can't handle my perfection. Don't, right where you are is good. Take your sandals off. You're on holy ground. And God said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. See, friends, what we need to remember is at this point in the story, about 40 years have passed. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? Like, any memory that Moses had of growing up in the Egyptian palace, right? Any aspirations that he had of, like, one day leading his people out of Egyptian captivity, right? That was 40 years ago. Like, some of you that are old enough, think back to 40 years ago. Think back to your days 40 years ago. I was 8 years old. I don't remember anything when I was eight. That's like such a distant memory. It's like a faint sort of kind of dream. Like, if I were Moses, I'd be wondering, like, did that even really happen? Because I forget all the details. There is someone who didn't forget. Verse 7 says, then the Lord said, I haven't forgotten. I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I've heard their cry because of their taskmasters. So the same things that you were concerned about 40 years, I see that. I've seen it. I haven't forgotten. I know their sufferings. And I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of what I call the Ites. Okay, you got the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. It was I, right? Verse 9. And now, some of you got that. You're like, thank you. Thank you for the, appreciate it. Verse 9, and now behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. And this is the verse. Verse 10, Exodus chapter 10. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Come, I want to use you. Yeah, you, the guy who's been in the wilderness for 40 years. Yeah, you, the one that tried to run away from his past. Yeah, you, the one that made that horrible mistake and then tried to cover it up. Yeah, you, the one that forgot about all your call and the vision and why. I want to still use you. I want to use you. I still got you. Two incredible truths that come from this text. It would be sinful for us to miss this. The first, if you're taking notes, is this. You may have forgotten your call. You may have lost the passion of your purpose. You may have forgotten even why you were created. But God hasn't. God has not. You see, maybe you're like Moses. Maybe like Moses, years and years have gone past you. They've just passed you by. And I'm not going to ask you to, you don't have to share with me, I'm not going to ask you to share with me, but just be like totally honest right now, just before the Lord, you and him, right? You may look at your life right now and realize, you know what? All these years have passed, and if I'm just honest, like, there's a lot of insignificance and irrelevance in my life. Like, I wasn't living the way that God intended. This isn't the life and life abundant that Jesus talks about. And if that's you, here's the great news. God was doing a work behind your back. God was still working in this place. Like, you feel like it's irrelevant, unimportant, insignificant, but God was doing a deep work inside of you, whether you realize it or not. God was working behind your back. Praise God. And he can redeem in one day, God can, what you're dilly-dallying over in fear and failure has caused 40 years to pass. He can redeem in one day. Do you believe that, church? One person believes it. So maybe you're here today and you somehow think that you've forfeited your call. Let's just be honest. Some of you think that you're on plan B. Some of you think you're on God's plan C, right? You think that you've diminished God's plan in your life, his work in your life. You feel like you're on God's plan B or plan C because you disqualified yourself from his plan A, which was like the deluxe package of years ago, right? But you feel like you've disqualified yourself from plan A, so now you're relegated to plan B or plan C or plan D because of the mistakes that you've made. But I'm here to tell you this morning that the only mistake you're making right now is you've forgotten how big God is. Yes. He is bigger than your mistakes. He is bigger than your failures. He is bigger than your fears. He is bigger than your past. That's what you've forgotten. The only mistake that you're making right now is forgetting the word of God, which clearly says, no interpretation needed. You just read it black and white. For the gifts and the calling of God are, what's the word there? Irrevocable. The gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. That's a legal term that, oh, by the way, is in a letter. It's a very legal letter to the citizens of Rome. Romans chapter 11, verse 29. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. I was talking to a lawyer this morning. That's a legal term. It literally means not able to be changed or reversed. God's gift to you and his call on your life, in other words, are final. You cannot mess it up, even if you've tried. And believe me, in my call, with my gifts, I've tried. I can't mess it up. I can't mess it up. God's gifts to you and his call on your life are final. You cannot mess them up. You cannot derail God. God graciously, patiently, lovingly won't allow it for your good and his glory. Amen? Which then leads us to our next point. I'm already 10 minutes over. I'm okay. All right. Whatever your story is, one thing I know about everyone in this room and everyone watching online, if you listen to it later in the week on the podcast, whoever it is, one thing I know about everyone here is that your past has passed. Brilliant, right? But that's true. Your past, no matter how good, bad, or ugly, it's past. Now, whether you choose to bring this past in an unhealthy manner to your present and then extend it onto your future, well, that's like a different story. That's on you. We can talk about that later. But your past has passed. And what God wants for you today reflects his goodness, his faithfulness, his love and mercy. That's what we see in our passage today when God, and I'm using this word very intentionally, rekindles. That's what we see today when God rekindles his call on Moses' life through this burning bush. Verse 10, come. I'm still gonna send you. I'm not on plan B where I work with Tom or Bob or, no. Still you. Still you. Come. I will send you to Pharaoh that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Just like you tried to do in your own way, in your own time 40 years ago. Guys, God has not given up on you. it's not in his nature. Hasn't given up on you, man. His gifts and call on your life today are no less radiant and brilliant as they were on your holiest of holy days. Like that time you were a youth group and you were at a retreat and crying and the snot's coming out and your hands raised up. And like in that moment, like it's just your call, his call on your life all these years later, it's no less brilliant and radiant and true than that moment. Why? Because it's not on you, it's on God. He is bigger than your past. He is faithful today as he will be tomorrow. And this same faithfulness and favor we see from God's hand towards Moses in Exodus chapter 3. Here's what this is just amazing. In my study this week, just preparing for the message, here's what I learned. I learned that we've got this Exodus 3 moment, right, where God rekindles his call. And then about 800 years later, there's a verse in the Old Testament book of Jeremiah, right? And if there's one verse in Jeremiah that Christianese know, if you grew up in Sunday school and whatnot, it's Jeremiah, what is it? It's Jeremiah 29:11, right? Great verse. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a what? Future, right? That we have it on bookmarkers. We have it on bumper stickers. Like, great verse. Awesome verse. But that same sentiment where God has this plan for Moses, plans for good, plans to prosper, right? Giving you hope in the future. That's echoed 800 years later through the prophet Jeremiah. And you know what's interesting? 800 years later after that prophecy through Jeremiah, guess what happens? It's echoed again in the Apostle Paul, in the church, in his writing to the church in Philippi, he says this, and I am sure of this, that he who began a good work, he who started a good work in the past, he's still working today. He's still for your future. He will continue to bring that to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. What is my point here? My point is that this message is consistent all throughout Scripture. From the second book of the Bible in Exodus through this main character, Moses, and we see it picked up through the prophets, and we see it then picked up through the apostles. God is so good, isn't he? Don't you want to get to know this God more and more? Don't you want to give your life to this God more and more? You know, maybe this is why I've been thinking a lot about this particular quote I'm going to share with you lately. I was actually just sharing it with some dear friends last night. Saint Ignatius of Loyola wrote it. He put it in the following way. He says, this is just like, he says, we should not fix our desires on health or sickness, wealth or poverty, success or failure, a long life or a short one. For everything has the potential of calling forth in us a deeper response to our life in God. Our only desire and one choice should be this: I want and I choose what better leads to God's deepening life in me. Oh my gosh, keep it up there. I see some people taking pictures. Keep it up there. Isn't that incredible? It's like, it doesn't matter if I'm rich or poor, it doesn't matter if I'm young or old, it doesn't matter if I'm healthy or not healthy. Like, God, like, whatever you want to use to help me fall deeper in love with you, just do it, God, just do it. Is that your heart? Is that your mindset? Isn't that incredible? Our only desire and one choice should be this: I want and I choose what better leads to God's deepening life in me. Friends, is that true for you? Is that what you want? Is that what you choose? Or do you even want to want it if it's not your choice? Whatever leads to God's deepening life in you. The Apostle Paul put it this way, and with this I'm gonna need to close here. In that same book, Philippians, the Apostle Paul writes, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. I'm not perfect. I'm not there yet. I haven't arrived. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind, forgetting good, bad, and ugly of the past, and straining towards what is ahead, whatever you put in front of me, God, straining forward. I'm going to strain. It's not easy. It's not a cakewalk. It's not cruise control. I'm going to strain to get there. My eyes are on it, though. Straining towards what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. And I love the way that he ends this thought. He says, all of us then, all of us who are mature, what is the implication there? The implication is if you don't think this way, you are spiritually immature. So get with the program. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things, forgetting what is behind, straining towards what is ahead. And if on some point you actually think differently, that too, God will make clear to you. Let's just live up to what we've already attained. Let's just be faithful with what you've already revealed to us. That's enough for me to manage right now. Want and choose whatever better leads to God's deepening life in you. Forget what's behind. Move towards what he's placed in front of you. And at some point, if you think differently, that too, I believe, and as your pastor, I pray that God would make it clear to you as you focus on him. But until then, let's just live up to what we've already taken. Let's just be faithful with like the next step he has in front of us. Amen. Friends, we need to stop here, present our tithes and offerings as an extension of our worship. This is no less spiritual, this act of responding in obedience and thankfulness to God and presenting our tithes and offerings. It's no less spiritual than submitting yourself to the word of God in a message or raising your hands in worship. And as we do that, the band's going to lead us in a song that reminds us of who we really are because of who he really is. Does that make sense? We can't find our identity apart from God. So with that in mind, let me just pray real quick. We'll continue to worship God in this way. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I want to pray specifically for the person right now who's living in Midian and they don't even know it. I want to pray specifically for that man, that woman, who upon honest self-reflection realizes, man, I'm not where, God, you've called me to be. I'm not where I've heard you say you would take me. And so I just want to confess that right now. And I want to ask you, Lord, help me to see my own failures and my own fears in a new way. And like Moses, who had his call, his gifts rekindled in a burning bush, I pray that today, through the power of your word, through the work of your spirit, might be a burning bush moment for that person right now. There is no reason why it needs to carry forth one more day. I pray that in the name of Jesus, they would hear your voice right now. Father, help us all, man, woman, and child. It's never too early, never too late. It's a man, woman, and child. Help us right now to have an attitude like Saint Ignatius, like the Apostle Paul, that whatever is behind, it's past. It's rubbish to me compared to the surpassing glory and greatness of knowing you better, of following you more intimately. Use everything in my life, every relationship and every brokenness to draw me closer to you. We ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus, all God's people said, amen. Let's all stand and continue to worship him.
Jesus died.
child. Amen. 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 So good. So good. We are not forsaken. We are not forsaken. He has a plan for us. Oh. Friends, here's the deal. I'm going to say something that I normally don't say, and that is, don't come to church next week. Okay? Turn to your friend and say, don't come to church next week. Now, before you get too squirrely, say to that same friend, we're taking the church to the beach next week. That's exactly what we're doing. I want to see every single one of you. Those of you online, come on out. We're going to be out in the outdoors. It's going to be great. We're going to the beach because we are celebrating people who say, you know what? I am a child of God. I'm a child of God. I don't have it all perfect. My life's not buttoned up. I still make mistakes. I still go here and there. But you know what? I am a child of God. I'm a child of God. I believe in Jesus. He loved me. He gave his life for me. He died for me. I don't have to die anymore. I don't have to die. I'm not crushed by the weight of sin. All right? And that's what being a child of God is. You're invited. You're adopted into the family of God through Jesus Christ. And we have over a dozen people that are getting baptized. Can we just thank God for that? We have over a dozen. Still counting. Pray for some of them because I heard that two of them caught COVID. So they're like, oh, we hope we can make it to baptism because they signed and they did their testimony and everything. But anyways, we have over a dozen people signed up. So it's just going to be amazing. And we want to celebrate that. This is one of my favorite Sundays of the year because it's some of the best preaching of the year because you're going to hear real life stories and how God just like, whoop, handpicked, handcrafted, did a work. And is doing something real and good in their lives. So it's just going to be an awesome time. It's going to be a party. One of our values is church is fun. It's hard to think of a more fun thing than that. We're going to be celebrating God's redemptive work in his creation with free lunch. I mean, I don't know what else to say. It's going to be a great time. So we'd love to see everyone there next Sunday. Having said that, I just love doing this. Person in the other service said that this is their favorite part of the service, and I was like, I don't know how I feel about that, but anyways, I'm going to ask you to extend your hands, palms up. This is a posture of releasing and a posture of receiving, and let's go to the Lord in this posture, and then I'll bless you with the benediction. Father God, we release. We release to you every failure that comes to mind. Every failure that tends to haunt us from the past. We release to you the doubts, the mistakes, the habitual sin, the broken relationships, the indifference and the apathy, the jadedness, the callousness. We release these things to you, God. And in their place, won't you graciously, lovingly, mercifully, wonderfully place back into our lives in a fresh way, in a rekindled way, your love, your goodness, your purpose and call in my life, your gifts and call which are irrevocable. Won't you give me more of yourself and help me to give you more of myself in return? And now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, through all ages, now and forevermore. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you guys. Love you guys. We'll see you next week at the beach.